Good morning. I'm honored to welcome you and call to order the 2011th stated meeting of the Academy. Well, it's been a wonderful weekend, and this is a terrific turnout for a Sunday morning. Just great to see you all here. You've heard about the Academy's noble history in nourishing the artistic and intellectual life of the nation and offering independent and principled advice to our leaders at critical inflection points in our country's evolution. One of our strengths derives from the wisdom of our members. We welcome your ideas for topics for our studies and publications and your active engagement in the work we do. And I have made that offer an invitation before, and I'm happy to say a number of people last night came up with ideas and offers of involvement, and I'm hoping that over the course of the year I'll have a chance to communicate with each and every one of our new members. So don't be bashful, be in touch. Over the past few weeks, I've learned firsthand that our induction weekend is an elaborate undertaking requiring a very precise choreography. And so I want to take a moment to thank the Academy staff for their tireless efforts at making this weekend raise your hands so we can, let's just raise your hands so we can see. There we are on both sides. This is really such a talented and dedicated and wonderful staff, and it's a team of people who care so deeply about this Academy and each other and about you. And this is a large family and one that is caring and decent and there to help you in any way we can. This weekend you've learned about our studies, about our publications and other activities in service to the public good. But throughout the history, we've also been the recipient of ideas, some solicited, some unsolicited, some good, some not so good. In March of 1800, Benjamin Franklin Stickney, the great grandnephew of Benjamin Franklin, wrote to the Academy at the urging of fellow John Prince. In his letter, Stickney described experiments in designing an alternative to the diving bell for descending and remaining underwater. Attached to the letter were careful sketches of the vessel's mechanical components, including a pair of double bellows connected to a hinge and lever and operated by foot, intended to assist in the circulation of clean air for the divers to breathe. It was Stickney's hope that the machine, or some improved iteration of his design, might be used to aid in the exploration of shipwrecks. Well, since its founding, the Academy has included many distinguished explorers among its members. Sir Joseph Banks, a participant in Captain Cook's exploration of the South Pacific on the HMS Endeavour. John C. Fremont, who helped chart the West, the American West. Joseph Dalton Hooker, an explorer of the Antarctic, who helped Charles Darwin classify plants collected in South America and the Galapagos Islands. And John Murray, the oceanographer and marine geologist, who discovered the Mid-Atlantic Ridge and the Oceanic Trenches. But this morning, I want to remember Benjamin Franklin Stickney, because our speaker may be the Academy Fellow who most nearly fulfilled Stickney's vision for the diving bell. So there's some history and tradition to what we're about to hear. Robert Ballard is a pioneer in the development of deep water submersibles and robotic undersea vehicle systems, and he's an explorer who's taken part, if I'm right, more than 140 deep sea expeditions. His discoveries include hydrothermal vents and their chemosynthetic animal communities in the deep sea, and such famous shipwrecks as the Titanic, the battleship Bismarck, John Kennedy's PT-109, and if I'm right, the U.S. aircraft carrier Yorktown. He's a veteran of the U.S. Navy and a professor of oceanography at the University of Rhode Island, and so it's a great pleasure to introduce a courageous scientist and explorer who has visited the depths of our planet in order to reveal its mysteries, and we're so happy that he's a new member of the American Academy, class of 2014, Robert Ballard.